Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Deep Fried Death by Maddie Day, narrated by Laural Merlington. Chapter 1. Whoever thought a parking lot full of brightly painted outhouses was a good idea had too much time on their hands. What could possibly go wrong? Plenty. What did we get ourselves into? I asked my co-chef Dana Beadle from the back seat of the pickup truck we'd borrowed as Turner Rao, my other full-time employee, drove the truck into the lot at the top of the hill. "Hey, you're the one who filled out the application form," she said. "It's good publicity for Pans N Pancakes," Turner added. "Now let's get this baby unloaded so we can all enjoy our Friday evening." The baby he referred to was our themed rustic outhouse, which of course wasn't a real outhouse at all. Kitted out with two small window boxes planted with real geraniums, the outhouse rested on a four-wheel base. It had a Dutch door in the front and a wide handle on the back for pushing or pulling it. Inside was a bench seat and a steering lever. The top Dutch door had the classic crescent moon cut out of it, and my country store restaurant's logo of a grinning stack of pancakes holding a skillet was painted on the back. This parking lot was on the highest hill in Nashville, the county seat for Brown County, Indiana. All the outhouses would race down the hill tomorrow morning, powered only by gravity, as part of the Abe Martin Festival. I didn't care if we won, but, as Turner pointed out, it was good publicity. After we successfully slid the outhouse down the portable ramps Turner's dad had included in the truck loan, I glanced around for direction. Camilla Kalb stood not far away. She owned Cammie's Kitchen here in Nashville, a popular homestyle eatery. Her entry resembled the restaurant, painted red and white with lace curtains at the fake windows. A cast iron skillet hung from a hook on one side and a muffin tin on the other. "I'll be right back," I told my team and headed her way. "Hey, Camilla," I said. "Do you know who's in charge?" She greeted me. "Zeke Martin is, Robbie, but he's being his usual pedantic self." She gestured across the lot. A man held a clipboard and was talking to a woman quite a bit shorter than he. "Thanks, I'll check with him." I'd heard of Zeke, but I hadn't realized he was the one organizing the race. "Good luck." She raised a penciled-on eyebrow. I made my way past the Nashville Library outhouse, the walls of which held real books on shelves. I passed the step-up thrift store outhouse and the South Lake Bikes entry, which had bike wheels in many sizes fixed to the sides. The Nashville Fire Department's was painted bright red. I slowed, blinking, at the sight of the person standing next to the entry for Hickory Fine Art Gallery. What was Jim Shermer doing here? "Jim?" I asked the man who had thrown over our budding romance a few years ago for a former lover, whom he was now married to. I no longer cared, being happily married myself. He turned, then took a step back. "Robbie Jordan." His gaze shifted anywhere but at my face, and he shoved his hands in the pockets of his khakis, as if to hide an onset of nerves. Jim's eyes were as green as ever, but the dark red hair, now tied back in a thin ponytail, had mostly disappeared from his brow. "I thought you were living in Indianapolis," I said.
We moved back to Brown County.
"It looks like you work at an art gallery." I didn't get to Nashville that often. Even if I'd been browsing the shops, acquiring fine art wasn't something I made a practice of.
"I actually own it."
He gestured at the outhouse walls, which were adorned with folk art in the style of Grandma Moses. I blinked again. He owned the gallery? He flipped his hands open.
"It's more interesting than real estate law."
"I suppose. Is Octavia still with the state police?" I'd met the detective after the body of a murdered woman had been deposited in my restaurant. It was during that case that she and Jim had reconnected in the fullest sense of the word.
"She is." He glanced at my Pans N Pancakes t-shirt, my daily uniform, albeit one that fit more snugly by the day. It was a bit early for much of a baby bump, but I could already feel my pregnant body growing fuller. A commotion drew my attention away. The woman Zeke had been speaking to threw a hand in the air and turned her back. Now that I was closer, I could see it was Evermina Martin, the proprietor of the new Miss Southlake Diner, a breakfast and lunch restaurant in direct competition with my own. Or at least that was how she'd positioned it. I'd heard she was also Zeke's ex-wife.
"Uh-oh,"
Jim murmured. Chapter 2. Zeke Martin blustered his way toward us. In his 40s, he looked trim in a blue polo shirt and linen Bermuda shorts. Unlike Jim's, his hairline was intact, his dark hair neatly styled. His features were anything but neatly arranged. He'd pressed his lips together and narrowed his eyes. The pale skin of his neck was mottled with red. He opened his mouth. "I didn't need anger in my life. Not today, not ever." I preempted him. "I'm Robbie Jordan. Where do you want the Pans N Pancakes entry?" I pointed behind me, vaguely in the direction of our outhouse. He tapped his pen on the clipboard. "You were supposed to have it here at 4 o'clock. "I run a business." I kept my cool. "We loaded up after we closed and cleaned the restaurant. We made it over here as soon as we could."
"It's only 4:30, Zeke," Jim said. "As long as your outhouse is in the lot, you can leave it anywhere."
He checked off my entry on his list. "We'll line everybody up in the morning. But don't be here any later than 8. Race gets going at 9 sharp. "Do you have overnight security?" I asked. Zeke performed a classic eye and head roll.
"You think somebody's going to steal a makeshift outhouse on wheels?" "It's a valid question. The business owners and organizations put a lot of work into these things."
Jim gave me a tentative smile. "People might have plans for them afterward. Plus, there's a big prize at stake." "Yeah, the big pot of fame and fortune, which was no more than an aluminum Abe Martin outhouse trophy and a picture in the Brown County Democrat." I smiled back.
"The lot's entrance and exit will be roped off after everybody clears out. I'll see you both in the morning."
Zeke strode away.
"Much ado about nothing, I'd say."
Jim shook his head. "Everybody has to have their fiefdom." I watched as Zeke gave the next entrance his officious treatment. A movement near the Miss Southlake Diner outhouse nearby caught my attention. A woman I'd never seen before squatted and peered at the wheel. Her sleeveless top showed off tanned and toned biceps. She looked about my age and had dark hair that fell in that way that expertly cut and styled locks do. Maybe she was a friend of Evermina's. I turned back to Jim. If running a fun festival makes Zeke feel powerful, so be it. Do you know what he does for a living?
He's a commercial illustrator, but he fancies himself a fine artist. Judging from the work he's tried to convince me to sell, he either doesn't work very hard at it or doesn't have a lick of talent.
He glanced behind me. "Hey, Jimmy," a woman's voice said. I turned, but not before I saw Jim cringe. "Can you give me a hand, hon?" Evermina stroked the corner of her green outhouse with one hand as she set her other hand on a cocked hip. The name of her diner was lettered on the side of the outhouse. A sign mounted on the roof read, "Best Eats in South Lick." The other woman had disappeared. "Hi there, Robbie. Do you know Jimmy?"
"I do," I said.
Her snug V-neck top was the same color as the outhouse. Evermina's tight jeans looked hot and uncomfortable to me, but they definitely showed off her curves. Her bouffant blonde hair and heavily made-up eyes seemed out of the previous century and made her look as much of a caricature as the folksy comic strip guy the festival celebrated. "Good luck tomorrow to you both," I said. "See you later, Jim." He gave me a desperate look, which I ignored. Jim was an adult. He could handle Evermina's come-hither look. Or he couldn't. It wasn't my problem.
I didn't need to spend any more time with either of them. I made my way back to my staff. Pans N Pancakes offered good eats in Southlick. We were a popular restaurant, and I was confident we could withstand competition from a new diner, as long as I got tomorrow's breakfast prep done. Chapter 3. They weren't kidding when they called it morning sickness. I usually felt fine later in the day, but beginning at about 4 a.m., I was just plain nauseous. I'd gone early to the restaurant Saturday morning to get the first batches of biscuits cut and into the oven. I mixed up the pancake batter and started the first pots of coffee. Too bad the smell of the brewing java, an aroma I loved and usually inhaled on purpose, made me feel even sicker. Still, I had a business to run. It was a stretch for Turner, Dana, and me to all be out on a weekend morning when Pans N Pancakes invariably had a line of hungry customers out the door. My fourth employee, Len Perlman, had arrived on time at 6:30, though, and Dana's mom, Mayor Corrine Beadle, had offered to help out until we returned after the race. She'd shown up at the appointed time, too. Now, climbing out of my car in Nashville at 7:45, I made sure to tuck a packet of saltines into my turquoise cross bag. I left my bike on the rack in the back for now. Before the race kicked off, I planned to ride down to the finish line to snap photos. Evermina must not have had a backup crew in place. When I'd driven by the Miss Southlick diner on my way out of town, the windows had been dark and the parking spaces in front of the retro metallic storefront were empty of cars. I nibbled on a cracker as I found my way to our entry. Dana, who usually dressed in colorful vintage flair, today sported a store t-shirt and denim cutoffs. She'd braided her red-gold dreadlocks into two fat plaits, tied with red ribbons matching her high-top tennies. All she needed was a set of fake freckles to complete the Sadie Hawkins look. She was today's star of the show, though. She'd volunteered to be our outhouse driver, riding inside and steering it to a win. Turner held a takeout cup of coffee in one hand and thumbed his phone with the other. He also wore a Pans N Pancakes shirt, but with black sports pants and running shoes. His role in the race was pushing the outhouse off to a good start. He'd also volunteered to run alongside in case a problem arose. "Hey, guys," I said. "You look great, Dana." Dana peered at me. "Are you feeling okay, Robbie? You aren't usually so pale." "Mornings are tough." I held up the cracker. "Have saltines, will travel." "Good," she said. A man with a big camera approached. "Photo for the Democrat, please." "Dana, you get in the middle," I said. "We'll flank you." She stuck a corncob pipe in her mouth and pulled a spatula out of her back pocket, holding it up and grinning. I set a hand on her shoulder and mustered a smile, while on her other side, Turner pointed to the logo on his shirt. The reporter snapped a couple of shots.
"Thanks. Pans N Pancakes is in Southlick, I gather."
"Yes, I'm the owner." I spelled all our names and told him of my staff's roles today. He thanked us and hurried over to the next entrant.
"It's strange, Robbie," Turner said. "There's no sign of Zeke Martin. Everybody's milling around without direction."
"Seriously?" I asked. "Yesterday he was adamant about being here promptly at 8 for a race that doesn't begin for another hour." It was true. I scanned the lot and didn't spy Zeke anywhere. Wendy Corbett stood next to her Nashville Treasures outhouse, which was painted to resemble her folksy gift shop here in town. A tall woman, nearing 50, she cast her gaze right and left, as if searching. Beyond her was Don O'Neill, my brother-in-law, with his green shamrock hardware outhouse. He always looked a little worried, the outer edges of his eyebrows drawn down. He had the same big brown eyes as my husband, Abe. But where Abe's expression usually sparkled with warmth or humor, Don's habitually appeared concerned, bordering on distraught. I wished Abe had been able to be here, but he'd taken his teen son, Sean, camping for the long weekend.
"I haven't seen... Wait, Turner said. There he is. A whistle pierced the air. Zeke, dressed in the corniest of straw hats, rolled up jeans and a plaid shirt under red suspenders, blew it again.
Is he trying to be Abe Martin himself? Dana asked.
No idea, I said. Who was this Martin guy anyway? Turner asked. Is Zeke related to him?
Not unless Zeke is fictional, too.
I smiled at Turner. Abe Martin was a Hoosier cartoon character drawn by an artist and journalist named Kin Hubbard more than 100 years ago. Abe Martin, who ostensibly was from Brown County, dispensed folksy wisdom often mixed in with political commentary.
Like, now and then an innocent man is sent to the legislature, for example.
Dana spoke in her best twang. Or, flattery won't hurt you if you don't swallow it, I added.
I like this guy, Turner said.
The whistle trilled again.
People, Zeke yelled.
He waited a moment until the chatter subsided. Please proceed to the starting line according to your entry number. We don't have all day.
What's our number, Robbie? Dana asked. Hang on.
I patted the pockets of my jeans shorts and came up with no piece of paper. Where had I stashed that thing? I snapped my fingers and fished it out of my bag.
We're 14.
Out of how many? Turner asked.
Not sure. 20?
Dana stood up tall and surveyed the lot from her 6-foot vantage point, bobbing an index finger as she counted.
I'd say 20's about right.
We're not going to all fit in a single line across the road, are we? Turner asked.
I don't know.
The whole event struck me as crazy, or at least mismanaged. Why didn't Zeke have any helpers to direct all of us? And once we did get to the start and the outhouses started rolling, they could crash into each other side by side, or one could bump into the one ahead as it picked up speed. Ours didn't have brakes. I didn't think any of them did. I wished I'd asked Dana to wear a bike helmet.
I'll run right next to the back handle, Turner added, as if he'd read my mind. I can grab it and slow the thing down if I need to.
If I'm about to face plat, you mean? Dana asked.
Something like that.
I took a deep breath.
All right, I think it's our turn.
I'll help push, Dana said. I don't need to get in until we're lined up. She and Turner got behind the outhouse and pushed to get it moving.
Was it this heavy yesterday? Turner asked.
I don't think so, Dana said. Doesn't matter. It's going to get a lot heavier once I get in. I finished my cracker and directed them. Jim Shermer and a woman with salt and pepper hair were pushing his entry ahead of us. I peered at her back. Yep, that was Detective Octavia Slade in the flesh. Jim's wife, but in casual Saturday attire. Clothes I'd never seen her wear. I glanced at where our outhouse was headed and swore silently.
Angle left, guys, I directed. Quick, you're about to hit the...
I was too late. The wheels on the right bumped into the lip of the curb at the entrance to the lot. The outhouse tilted left and then forward. Turner yanked back on the bar as the doors on the front flew open. A person fell out. A dead person. Chapter 4. My breath rushed in. Evermina Martin lay crumpled on the pavement. Her body had stiffened in a sitting position, with her neck stretched sideways and her chin on her chest. A cast iron skillet had tumbled out after her. A bloody lump stained her blonde hair.
OMG!
Dana stared. Turner joined us.
No wonder it was so heavy, he whispered,
the color draining from his face. He brought his hand to his mouth. I knelt. Evermina looked dead, but I had to be sure. I laid 2 fingers on her neck. She didn't have a pulse. Nobody with skin that cold and a body that stiff could be alive. She couldn't have cracked her own head with the skillet. This was homicide. And a law enforcement officer was right in front of me.
Octavia,
I called. She turned. I beckoned. Her eyes widened.
She hurried back. Ahead of us somewhere, Zeke kept blowing his whistle. Behind us, people were asking what the holdup was. All I could see was Evermina and that lump on her head. My eyes blurred with tears at a life cut short, at her violent end. I sniffed and pushed up to standing. My emotions were way out of whack these days, and I cried at the least provocation, not that murder was the least of anything. Octavia and the photographer arrived at the same moment. He whistled and aimed his camera. "Keep your distance, sir," she told him in a stern voice. She pulled a slim ID wallet out of her pants pocket and flashed it at him. "State police."
"Yes, ma'am."
"Robbie?" she asked. "Our outhouse hit a bump. She fell out and the skillet with her. Her name is Evermina." My stomach roiled. "Excuse me," I mumbled as I dashed for a row of bushes and lost my breakfast of crackers. I stayed there until I was sure the bout of upchucking was over. I rinsed my mouth, glad I'd tucked a small bottle of water into my bag. Now I really wished Abe were here. By the time I returned, Jim had approached. A crowd was gathering at the periphery. Octavia spoke into her cell as she gazed at Evermina. Don pushed through the crowd and gasped. His cheeks paled.
"Robbie, this is terrible."
"I'll say," I swallowed. "You okay, Rob?" Dana asked. "Sort of. Can you and Turner help keep people back until the police get here? I'm pretty sure our outhouse is now a crime scene." I'd unfortunately been around more crime scenes than I wanted to count. "You got it," she conferred in a quiet voice with Turner. He nodded. "Don, you stay back too," I said.
Of course."
He melted back into the sea of staring faces. Dana and Turner each took a side and extended their arms straight out, facing the people massing. With Dana's height, she had an impressive wingspan. She inched forward, urging those in front of her to move back. She ignored their questions. Turner also widened the circle and kept his mouth shut. The photographer squatted and shot more pictures of the body. He turned his camera on our poor outhouse, which made me cringe.
"Do you know the lady's name?"
he asked me. Over my shoulder, Octavia caught my eye and shook her head hard. "You'll have to get that from the authorities," I said. Octavia slid her phone into her pocket. "Sir, I'm going to have to ask you to leave and to hold off filing your story."
"But,"
he objected. Zeke hurried up. "What's holding things up? Why aren't you—" His voice trailed off. He stared at his ex-wife's corpse.
"That's Evie."
He looked up. "She's my ex.
What happened?"
The photographer perked up and murmured, "Got it. Evermina Martin of the Miss South Lick Diner." He got off a couple of shots of Zeke staring at the body. "Everybody take 2 steps back." Octavia's loud voice oozed authority. "Now." Chapter 5. We stepped. A police officer in a black uniform strode up, one hand on her heavy duty belt. Blonde hair to her shoulders, she wasn't much taller than my 5'3", and she didn't appear a lot older than me either. I'd turned 31 2 weeks ago. "Chief Harris," Octavia nodded at her. She was the police chief? She must have been older than she looked.
"Ma'am? What do we got?"
The chief, who seemed to know Octavia, frowned down at Evermina. "I'm off duty, obviously." Octavia gestured at her t-shirt and capris. "This is Robbie Jordan of Southlick. The victim, Evermina Martin, was in Robbie's business's outhouse and fell out. So did the frying pan. I happened to be helping my husband with his entry. Robbie called me over." The chief squinted at our outhouse. "Pans N Pancakes. That your pan?" She pointed her chin at the skillet. "Not unless someone stole it out of my store and brought it here." I flashed on Camilla's outhouse. The Cammy's kitchen entry had one hanging on the outside yesterday when we all delivered our entries. "Did you know a person was inside this one?" Harris asked.
"No."
I couldn't believe she'd ask that. How could we?
We delivered it empty, but it sat here on the lot all night.
Who's we? Harris didn't look convinced.
Dana Beadle and Turner Rao, two of my employees. I pointed to them. Yesterday I asked Zeke Martin if he'd arranged overnight security. He said he hadn't. I fixed my gaze on Zeke. Harris cocked her head at Zeke.
Is that correct, Mr. Martin?
He swallowed.
Yes.
Two more Nashville officers, both male, hurried up, one holding a roll of yellow plastic tape. A siren whooped its way ever closer. Wendy Corbett, whose outhouse had been one of the first to leave the lot, slipped in next to Zeke and tucked her hand through his arm. She squeezed and murmured in his ear. It looks like Zeke had moved on, post-divorce.
All right, the diminutive chief set her fists on her hips. Mr. Martin, the race is canceled. Ms. Jordan, you and your employees will please adjourn to the police station and wait to be interviewed. You too, Mr. Martin. Detective Sergeant Slade, thank you for your help.
Yes, ma'am, Octavia said. I'm available if you need me.
We'll see whether they assign us state or the county sheriff, or both. Harris rubbed her neck.
You'll call for the MSCU, of course, Octavia added.
The Miss Q? What was that?
Of course, Harris sounded peeved. As Octavia turned to go, she murmured to me, Mobile Crime Scene Unit.
Ah, thanks.
My confusion must have been obvious. The chief faced her officers. Protect the crime scene. Use the lampposts and find a couple of stanchions to complete the circuit. One of the guys trotted off. The other tied one end of the tape to the nearest post. An ambulance with lights and siren alive crept down the road from the far end of town, people parting in front of it. It went silent, and two EMTs jogged up carrying their red bags. Wendy nudged Zeke.
Chief, Zeke began, can't the outhouses already lined up be allowed to race? It'll get them out of here, and they've already arranged to transport their entries from the finish line at the bottom of the hill after the run is over.
Harris gave that a moment of thought.
Good idea. Go ahead. Be sure you come by the station after it's over to be interviewed.
I promise.
He didn't look enthusiastic about it, though. And I'll need a list of all the entrance names. These last few outhouses in the lot can exit through the far egress, but tell them they're not going to be able to get to your starting line. This road is closed for the duration.
Chapter 6. By 9:30, my crew and I still sat in the waiting room of the building the police shared with the town hall offices. Dana had texted her mom to say our return to Southlake was on hold, and why. I'd used the facilities, and had now resumed nibbling on saltines. At 9, we'd heard the roar of the crowd lining the race route from in here, even though we were several blocks away. The competition was over pretty fast. A dispatcher in a black polo shirt was the only staff member I'd seen, and she sat behind darkened glass. I'm sorry you guys had to see the body, I said to Dana and Turner. Neither of you has witnessed a murder victim before, right?
I did, Dana raised her hand. Remember that woman who was killed and her body dumped behind the pickle barrel in the store?
Erica Berry. How could I forget?
I asked. You came into work right after I'd found her. We'd only been open, like, barely 2 months, Dana added.
I'm lucky you didn't quit on the spot. I smiled at her. I wouldn't do that to you.
I'd be happy never to see another scene like that one, Turner said. It's horrible to think of a murderer attacking Ms. Martin in the middle of the night and stuffing her in our race entry. Who would have done it, Robbie? Do you have any ideas?
No.
I took a sip of water. I'd grabbed another bottle at the Quick Pick on our walk down here, while Dana and Turner bought coffees. I mean, she was divorced from Zeke, and they seemed to be arguing yesterday during the drop-off. But I don't know either of them.
I hope the police don't suspect you, Dana said. She mounted quite the nasty campaign against Pans N Pancakes after she opened her diner.
Did she actually badmouth our much-loved restaurant? Turner asked. Who would think that would ever work?
I let out a breath. She seemed to be heading in that direction. I tried to convince her Southlick had room for two breakfast and lunch places. She apparently thought hers wouldn't make it as long as mine was still in business. She plastered an ad all over the internet only last week, Dana said, about how you could get a real Hoosier breakfast solely at the Miss Southlick Diner, and how it had the only decent food in the county. I mean, seriously? Now I know why the diner was dark this morning when I drove past, I said. Evermina was dead. I wondered if the skillet had been the murder weapon. I supposed if she was whacked with enough force in the right spot, it could have killed her. Skulls were pretty hard, though. I glanced at the outer door as it opened. Wanda Bird pushed through it, a former Southlick police officer, and the cousin of our current chief, Buck Bird. She was now a detective with the Brown County Sheriff's Department. Her tan uniform polo shirt strained over her belly. She'd lost a lot of weight before her wedding last year, but now she was over halfway through her own pregnancy and was looking more than full of figure again. Hey, Robbie. I heard about the, incident and thought I'd see what the situation is down here.
The situation, Wanda, is that we're waiting for someone to interview us, I said. I don't know if it'll be Chief Harris, you, Detective Slade, or who. What I did know was that I wanted to get out of here. The benches were hard. I was getting hungry for real food, and I had a volunteer doing half the work at the business I owned.
Haley's good people, Wanda said. She'll be along soon enough.
Haley is the chief's first name? I asked.
Yep-a-roo.
Wanda spoke in the same folksy way Buck did. While it didn't sound professional, I'd learned over the years it didn't reflect their intelligence and had no bearing on their competence as law enforcement officers.
You know what, Robbie? Wanda asked. I picked me up a little intel at the victim's diner a couple few days ago.
You ate at the competition? Dana pretended to be outraged.
Hey, after them ads came out, I had to see what was what, and it was Monday when y'all are closed.
It's fine, Wanda, I said. What did you learn?
Well, it seems your own brother-in-law was having him a couple few words with old Evermina.
Don? I scrunched my nose. Do you mean they were arguing?
I sure as shootin' do.
He said she owed him a cow patty load of money. He up and demanded she pay it.
Money for what?
Turner asked.
Why, for the renovations on her diner, course. She bought all manner of supplies at Shamrock Hardware, but she put it on account. He wasn't a bit happy about her still being in the red with him. Might could be motive for murder.
What? I asked. Don O'Neill is one of the gentlest men I know.
And if he killed her, she'd never be able to pay him, Dana pointed out.
I'm sure Chief Haley'll get to the bottom of it all, possibly with our help, Wanda said. And there she is now.
Sure enough, the chief hurried in. Zeke followed her at a slower pace. If anybody had ever looked reluctant to be in a police station, it was him. His feet dragged and his lips pressed together.
Sergeant Bird, Harris began, are you in possession of information I'm not aware of?
Nope. Just thought I'd drop by, hon, and make myself useful.
Thank you, but until I receive official word, we have this under control. The skin was tight around the petite chief's blue eyes, and her fists on hips stance appeared challenging, not under control.
Okie dokie, then. Be seeing you, Robbie, folks.
Wanda bustled out the door.
What's she so happy about? Dana muttered.
I don't know, but she's a lot more cheerful than she used to be, I murmured in return. Maybe being secure in job, love, and impending motherhood contributed to replacing her former swagger with a sunny disposition. Or it could be hormones.
Sorry to keep you all waiting,
Harris said to my crew and me. Did you three drive over together?
I drove separately, I said. If you wouldn't mind interviewing me first, ma'am, I really need to be getting back to my restaurant, which is being run by a skeleton crew.
Very well.
You two okay with that? I asked Dana and Turner.
Sure,
Turner said. Totally, Dana agreed. Mom said she doesn't mind staying on. We'll be back as soon as we can.
What about me?
Zeke's tone was plaintive.
Have a seat, Mr. Martin, Harris said. Please come with me, Ms. Jordan.
She might as well have told him to take a number. He sat. I followed her into the back. Chapter 7. The vaulted exposed beam ceiling and the wood-paneled cabinets gave the Nashville PD station a country lodge kind of feeling, except most country lodges didn't include a uniformed woman with a gun and a tasing device hanging off her belt. I'd been inside the Southlick police station more than once and had visited the Brown County Sheriff's facility, but I'd never been in here until now. Harris led me to a stark interview room. After the preliminaries of asking for my name and address, stating the date and time, and acknowledging that she was recording, she folded her hands on the table. Please lead me through the sequence of events leading up to the victim's remains falling out of your race entry, beginning with yesterday. I told her we'd loaded the outhouse onto Turner's father's truck in Southlick after we closed my restaurant.
You built it there at your store?
She asked. Yes, in the barn behind it.
Go on.
We drove it here, I said. We unloaded it in the staging lot. We left. That's pretty much it. Who did you speak to yesterday?
I said hello to Camilla Kolb. She told me Zeke Martin was organizing the race, and I greeted Jim Shermer, who now owns the art gallery.
Do you collect art? Harris asked. No, but he was my real estate agent when I bought my country store property a few years ago. And he'd been my boyfriend for a little while, but she didn't need to know that. Except it might be 5 years ago already, or maybe four. I'd already been in Brown County for 3 years, working as a chef right here in Nashville when my mom died without warning of a burst brain aneurysm at our home in Santa Barbara. She'd taught me carpentry as I grew up, and the sale of the house and her cabinetry business left me a nice chunk of change. I didn't have siblings to split it with, and I was able to buy the Southlick property and use my skills to do most of the reno work myself. Working with my hands to make my dream of owning a restaurant come true had also helped with my grief. You probably know Jim Shermer is married to Octavia Slade, I continued. She nodded. Who else did you talk to? I found Zeke, told him we'd arrived, and asked him where to leave our outhouse. He didn't have a system in place at all, except to show up at 8 this morning and move our entries to the starting line.
Did you speak to the victim?
Why did these people never use the dead person's name? I briefly said hello to Evermina. Before that, I saw Zeke and her having a disagreement. I have no idea what it was about.
Had you had any prior dealings with her?
Was she asking because she already knew? It didn't matter. All I could speak was the truth. After she opened the Miss Southlick diner, Evermina mounted a campaign apparently aimed at putting my restaurant out of business. I explained about the social media ads and that I'd attempted to convince her, once, that we could peacefully coexist. She didn't seem to agree. The chief had fired up a tablet and now fast typed into it. And where were you between 8 p.m. and, say, 5:30 this morning?
Uh-oh.
I was home, with nobody to vouch for me. This morning I was at my restaurant before 6 to do breakfast prep. We open at 7, and then I drove here.
Do you live alone?
No.
Who do you live with?
She gazed at the wedding band on my left hand, the band I'd worn for a year tomorrow. My husband, Abe O'Neill, and my stepson, Sean.
Can they vouch for your whereabouts?
No. They left yesterday afternoon on a camping trip.
Did you come back to Nashville after dark and hit Evermina Martin on the head with a cast-iron skillet?
I looked into her eyes.
No.
Did you stuff her dead body into your outhouse and close the doors?
No.
I shut my mouth and stood so I didn't yell at her.
Is that all?
She pushed up to standing.
I'll be in touch.
Haley Harris might look young and sweet, but this police chief had a will of iron, which was a good thing, as long as she didn't aim it at me.
Chapter 8. I made a high-speed stop at home on the way to the restaurant. My stomach had settled by now, so I wolfed down a cheese sandwich. I suspected things at Pans N Pancakes would be too busy for me to be able to eat after I arrived. I was right. A line of holiday weekend customers waited to be seated. Len poured and flipped orders at the grill as fast as he could. He looked like he could really use a break. So did Corrine, bless her mayoral heart. I'd never seen her frazzled before. She'd worked as a wait person in her past, and she loved schmoozing. But hours of serving and bussing and pouring coffee without a break was a lot to ask of anyone, let alone a volunteer. She'd jammed a store ball cap on her big hair. Under her apron, she wore a Pans N Pancakes shirt over pressed jeans and red sneakers that matched Dana's. Right now, the shirt bore a smear of syrup, and the big hair hung limp. I hurried to scrub my hands and tie on a store apron. "Take a break, Corrine." I relieved her of the now empty coffee pot. To Len, I added, "I'll spell you when she's back. Plus, Dana and Turner won't be long." Corrine slipped out of the blue apron and tossed it in the soiled linens box under the counter. "We have to talk. About what happened." She arched her well-plucked eyebrows as she patted her phone-carrying back pocket. She made a beeline for the restroom at the back. "I set two more pots of calf and one of decaf to brew."
"What happened, anyway?"
Len slid two finished plates under the warmer. Corrine got a text, and it was like the world stood still.
"I'm sorry, dude. I can't tell you right now. Soon."
"Okay."
He pointed. "Those are for Adele and her friend."
My Aunt Adele was here?
I already felt better. I loaded up the plates and scanned the tables until I saw them.
"Robbie, hon."
Adele Jordan, my late mom's older sister, greeted me with a big smile. "You remember Vera."
"It's lovely to see you again, Vera."
I sat down the plates and gave each woman's cheek a kiss. Both had the soft skin of a person in her mid-70s, with Vera's a darker shade than Adele's.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.